Hi, welcome to Greater Reading Public Eye. I'm Robin Costenbader-Jacobson. I'm the producer and host of Greater Reading Public Eye at BCTV. And if you haven't watched the program before, or you have, I just want to remind you and share with you that this is a personal interview show. I love to share with you as our home viewers, people in our community that you may be familiar with, you may not know from behind the scenes, or people who are behind and in front of the scenes. And normally I interview one guest, and today's show I'm interviewing two. So I hope you'll enjoy both of our guests. They are not originally from Berks County, Greater Reading area, so I always find it interesting when people join our community, what makes them stay. What do they find intriguing? What are things that they may see not being native? So I hope you'll stay tuned through the show. And again, this is Greater Reading Public Eye, sponsored by RCJ Consulting Associates. With that said, I'm going to introduce you to both of our guests this evening. Next to, well, not quite next to me, but on the opposite side of me is, should be a very familiar face, especially if you're familiar at all with BCTV over the years, and Sheehan.
Hi, Robin.
It's great to have you here.
Thank you.
And you have a lot of new and different things going on since your fairly recent retirement from BCTV, so we're going to chat about those things today and get all our home viewers updated on what you've been up to, okay?
Good. Thank
and you. You're welcome. Thanks for taking the time. Next to Anne, between us, is Dr. Noahleen Betts. Many of you may be familiar from the work that she does as a podiatrist in our community, and she's going to share where she is right now, because you've had a transition in your career.
Absolutely.
To some extent, and have slowly but actually quickly been transitioning your career. And so we'll bring everybody up to date on that as well.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much, both of you, again, for being here, because I know it's evening time that we're doing the show, and it's always nice to go home and relax at the end of the day. So thank you, and know that all of us tuned in really appreciate it.
Thanks.
You're welcome. I mentioned to our home viewers that you are both not natives of the Greater Reading area. So let's start with you, Anne.
Okay.
What brought you here? What's your background? Because what little I know has always intrigued me.
Oh.
And you just shared more with me this evening that I had no clue about.
Okay. Well, I grew up in New York.
City or
Queens,
state?
In Queens.
Queens, okay.
Yeah. I'm the youngest of four children. And let's see, so I went to school till I was 16 in New York, and then my parents and I moved to Florida. So I finished high school in Florida. I did my first year of college at the University of Miami. And then I moved back to New York and finished my degree at Fordham University.
Oh, nice.
I always like to say that it was back in the day when girls were not allowed to go up to the Bronx campus.
Oh,
so
yes.
We had to go downtown, which was great because I got to know downtown Manhattan, and I loved it. I still love it. When I graduated from college, I joined the Peace Corps. And I went to West Africa, to Togo, which is a very small country. Mm-hmm. I taught English as a foreign language and other things for 2 years. I came back and moved to California, got married, visited California with my soon-to-be husband. He was living out there because he was in the Navy.
Mm-hmm.
We got married out in California, and then he was transferred to Newport, Rhode Island, so we moved to Rhode Island. And had our first child there, and then we moved back to California and had our second child there. Then he got out of the Navy, went to UCLA graduate school.
Okay.
And that's really what brought us to Pennsylvania. Because
okay. How did going to UCLA grad school bring you to Reading, PA?
Well, because he got his master's degree at UCLA, and then mm-hmm. he came to University of Pennsylvania to a doctoral program.
Okay.
And we had two children, mm-hmm. two toddlers, and I was pregnant with our third child. And it wasn't really, Philadelphia was not conducive to being a young student family.
Right.
So we did. We followed the Reading Railroad, and that's how we ended up in Berks County.
Really?
That's serious when you said that. I was serious, yes.
Wow.
Because we lived in Douglasville. We had an apartment in Douglasville, and he would take the train into Philadelphia.
Go to Philly.
Wow.
Huh. How about that?
Yeah. And then he finished his degree, and just at the time, he finished all his coursework just at the time that New York University was getting started here with BCT, what became BCTV.
Oh, wow.
So he was hired. I was working at Sears at the time. Mm-hmm. And
Sears at the Berkshire Mall?
No, Sears at Coventry Mall.
Oh, okay. See that? Okay.
And then what happened? I'm trying to think. Oh, then they had an opening for a camera person, and I applied for it, and I got that.
Here?
And, yeah.
BCTV needs to do a historical show and get all that documented.
We actually...
It's so interesting.
You know,
did you do that for an anniversary?
When we had our 30th anniversary.
Okay.
Mike Selinsky produced it.
Yeah.
An hour-long documentary.
Yeah, yeah, I'd like to see it. I didn't see it at that time. Yeah.
It's been a pretty interesting history.
Yeah, it really is. So. Truly. Right here in Reading,
right
PA.
Right here in Reading, PA. Mm-hmm.
Wonderful.
Yep.
So thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Dr. Betts, you too have come by way of New York.
Absolutely.
Directly or indirectly, but share your history with us.
Well, I was born and raised in Sierra Leone, West Africa, the capital, Freetown, and was very fortunate to be one of the young girls in Sierra Leone who had a dream to become a doctor one day. So when I graduated from high school, I had the blessed opportunity to apply to St. Augustine's College in Raleigh, North Carolina, their small Episcopal school that recruited students. So I applied and I got in. And fortunately, very grateful that my parents were able to come up with tuition so that I could be able to matriculate. Because at the time, you actually had to show good faith. Not only were you required to have the grades to come, but you had to also have financial backing. So once you come and excel, then you would get the help. So I was really, really lucky, one of the really lucky ones who knew about the program, applied, got in, and was able to make it. In undergrad, I wanted to major in pre-med, but was advised that biology was a good thing to do just in case you didn't get into medical school right away. So I did that, majored in biology, and then applied to New York College of Podiatric Medicine and got in there. So, you know, very grateful, and stayed in New York for about 10 years.
Wow.
And at the time, my then boyfriend, who was going to be my husband, moved to Reading. He was actually working at a job that had an account at the Twin Towers.
Okay.
So when the World Trade Center fell, his income plummeted too at the time, and he had to switch jobs. So he had family out here in Reading, and he decided to come out here and pursue that.
How about that?
Yes. So I was still in New York. I had a contract with the Health and Housing Corporation, so I was working there. And once my contract was over and we were going to start a family, I decided to apply for podiatry out here, and I moved.
In Pennsylvania?
Yes. Yep.
Was that difficult, or did it go pretty smoothly?
Oh, no, it was extremely difficult.
Oh, wow.
Very difficult, because in Manhattan, where I lived, I actually lived across the street from the hospital where I worked.
Wow.
Yes. So, yes, that was, I didn't have a car at the time. So when I actually was applying for work in residency in the area, the closest one on the application was actually 38 miles from Reading, which was the application address was in Collegeville.
Okay.
Yes, but the hospital was in Norristown.
Oh, wow.
Right. So here I am just having to wake up in the morning, walk across the street to Metropolitan Hospital on 99th and 1st. And I was thinking about that my commute was only going to be 38 minutes or 38 miles. It didn't sound too bad. And then when I actually interviewed in Collegeville, I was told, no, the hospital is even further, which is like an hour away. So I was coming into an environment where I had to now drive about an hour each way. And I always said this to my friends in the city. I said, if I leave 1 minute after 6 p.m. To get to work, I should add on 15 minutes of being late.
Absolutely.
So it was a great shock, a great transition, but I stuck with it. And it was actually the podiatrist that I interviewed with in Collegeville and Norristown, when I decided that the commute was getting a bit too much, that I needed to start my own practice locally, they were actually very, very helpful in supporting me to actually open up my own practice in Reading when I decided to leave. So they held my hand each step of the way.
Oh, that was great.
So I've been extremely fortunate, to have had people who have helped me in my education, upbringing, and professionally. So I'm entirely grateful. And I, every day when I wake up, I feel blessed, and I always want to give back, starting with children.
Yes.
It's really important because I had parents who were there for me. Mm-hmm. I'm grateful for that. Had teachers who said it was okay, even at the time when I was growing up, that it was difficult for a young girl to dream. Just have a dream. You know, as Miss Anne was saying, that when you went to Fordham, right, girls couldn't go to the Bronx campus. At least you know, in being in America, it was something that was a possibility. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But coming from Sierra Leone, a young girl, you know, it was really, really something that I had to push at to do. It wasn't easy.
So much probably seemed impossible.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Like mountains, you know, the mountain is there and you say, how can I just move this mountain and literally get across, you know, the Atlantic Ocean, and dare to want to come to the United States of America and excel. So I believe that because of how fortunate I have been, it is my responsibility to ensure that every child within my reach has the same dream and has the ability to overcome and to achieve those dreams and make them a reality.
Well, and we're going to talk about how you go about doing that, both of you, and the things that you've done. So first of all, you definitely should be asked the question, what's love got to do with it? For real.
Absolutely.
So, wow. So that I don't remember. I know you've told part of that story before when I've been in hearing shot, but I didn't hear the hospital across the street part. Yes. That's tough.
That was terrible. Wow. I used to have headaches literally just driving in the morning, and then the commute after work, sometimes it was just better to be in the hospital till 9 o'clock. And then know that you're going to drive without traffic, but you dare to leave at 5 or 6.
Forget
that,
it.
Yeah, two hours.
It's still like that. Maybe worse. So, Anne, you recently, in the last few years, left BCTV as a long-term executive director. And I knew when you were leaving that you would be doing something else. It was just a matter of what, where, and when. Right. So what have you been up to? Because, again, you always have the pulse of the community in whatever you're doing.
So when I left BCTV, I went on a pilgrimage walk that didn't end well for me.
Oh, that's right.
So I was laid up for about 6 months.
Was it your ankle?
It was my ankle. I broke my ankle.
Yeah.
And had to have a few surgeries on it. But so I was laid up for about 6 months. And after I got over that. I tried volunteering at a couple places, mm-hmm. and I wasn't a good match, or it was not a good match for me. Mm-hmm. And then I found a part-time job at the Wyomissing Public Library, and I love it. I'm an assistant librarian, so I help people find books mm-hmm. and CDs and all that. And I'm also doing some development work for them, part-time.
Raising money.
Raising mm-hmm. money, yeah, and helping.
Yeah, libraries are broke.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
They need contributions.
Yeah, it's a great library. Mm-hmm. There are kids from all over the county come there.
Oh, wow, I didn't realize that. So I thought it was more exclusive to the immediate community.
It's
an adorable library. Yeah. I've been
it's
in it.
It's a wonderful library, yeah.
Really nice.
And they have great programs. Mm-hmm. They have a really good staff and a good board of directors. But yeah, it's open to anybody in the community.
That's
to
good
come
too.
In and use it. Yeah, it is. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people from Reading use it. Mm-hmm. We get kids from Reading who come over. And
that's great
to
know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, and I know there's the exchange program between and among the libraries mm-hmm. as well. If Reading doesn't have something, they put the word out.
Yeah, and if you borrow a book from Sinking mm-hmm. Spring, but you happen to be in the Wyomissing neighborhood, you can drop it off at Wyomissing.
Right. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. There's some great features, the e-books mm-hmm. and everything else.
Yeah.
So with that said, I want to go back to, we're talking about community and involvement, you run the Miss Teen Reading pageant that just took place for 2017.
Right. And thank you so much for your support,
Miss
Robin and Miss Anne. Mm-hmm. Thank you for your financial support. Mm-hmm. Thank you for coming out and actually seeing how the program comes together. The Miss Teen Reading PA organization is actually for girls between the ages of 13 and 19. I had started a nonprofit, which is Africa Lower Limb, mm-hmm. back when I finished podiatry and wanted to give back to the continent and other smaller third world mm-hmm. countries and islands. So when I was coming back from one of the trips in Africa, there was a New York Times article, and the New York Times article was, Reading is poor, it just doesn't realize how poor it is. Mm-hmm. Well, if anybody knows any history about Sierra Leone, we had a 12-year civil war, and Sierra Leone made the United Nations poorest country,
right.
I think more than once and more times than I'd like to actually remember. And I was sitting there saying, how can I be from a poor country and then end up in a poor city? And, you have the conscience and, okay, so here I am, fortunately being able to take care of myself and my family, being fortunate, but I'm taking money from this poor city that I live in and going back to Sierra Leone. So I prayed about it, thought about it. I had lots of sleepless nights saying that it would be hypocritical. Mm-hmm. You have to do something at home. Mm-hmm. This is home now.
Right.
This is where you are. So after thinking about it and praying, I tried to find first of all, how could I help was the first thing. Mm-hmm. Secondly, who would understand and who can I connect with? How? Mm-hmm. So one of the things that I thought about was asking the principal of Reading High whether I could come into the auditorium and talk to the students and say, I was from a poor country, born and raised. You can make a difference. One at a time, you can make good choices, mm-hmm. get an education, and move from the poor sector to middle class. So I said, well, if I stood in the auditorium, I don't think they'll get it because they wouldn't see the young poor girl from Sierra Leone in me.
Right, right, exactly.
So how can I make the impact one-on-one? Mm-hmm. And I was talking to one of my friends who was one of my patients who became my friend, mm-hmm. That mm-hmm. kind of relationship. And I said, I think that I would make the greatest impact on young girls.
Right.
13 through 19. I said, but if I just talk to them, I don't think they'll believe what my background mm-hmm. was. I said, so I want to spend more time How do I spend more time? So I said, I thought about doing a pageant, but it wouldn't be a beauty pageant. It would be a collegiate pageant, because one of the things they talked about in the article was the poverty rate being directly linked to the lack of education. They did the statistics of how many men and women had GEDs, first degrees, and then did link the income. So I said, I want to do a pageant, but in order for them to compete, they have to be willing to graduate from high school, and the young ladies must commit to matriculating in any post-secondary or tertiary institution, right, whether it's technical, mm-hmm, or, you know, 2-year degree, 4-year degree, you must commit. Mm-hmm. So that's how the Miss Teen Reading PA Collegiate Scholarship Pageant came about.
And we need to share that more with the community, not just Reading itself, but the entire Reading area, the greater Reading area, so that more people are aware of it, because it's a great opportunity for the participants.
Absolutely.
Forgive me, we're getting to the end of the show, and I just wanted to share with our home viewers, as you can tell, home viewers, we could go on and on with these two guests, Dr. Noahleen Betts and Ann Sheehan, and we've been talking this evening about their community involvement, where they came from, why they've stayed in the area, and we also want to share with you, home viewers, that the three of us are on a venture together, or an adventure, and I currently sit on the board of directors of the Reading School District, and it's been a great pleasure and honor for me to work with the school district on behalf of not only our children, but our taxpayers and the residents of Reading, but especially our children. And Dr. Betts and Sheehan will be running as well. So stay tuned. You'll be seeing our faces around a little bit more. Thanks for tuning in, and we hope you have a wonderful month ahead.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.